All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's start. Dear friends, welcome to the embassy. It is our pleasure to have you here. This event tonight is very, very important. It focuses on Crimea, but not only on Crimea. As you know, Ukraine is defending in a war that's been going on for over a year. And the annexation of Crimea was the first step in that war, in the Russian aggression. Last month, we commemorated the 71st anniversary of the deportation of Crimean Tatars in 1944, when Stalin regime removed 230,000 Crimean Tatars in a matter of days. The entire Crimean Tatar population on the false charges of treason and collaboration with Nazi Germany. Between 1944 and 1947, 46% of Crimean Tatars died in exile of starvation and disease. After Ukraine became independent in 1991, the government was taking all possible steps to help Crimean Tatars resettle on the peninsula. And before the Russian aggression, the Crimean Tatar population was up to 270,000, or comprising roughly 13% of Crimean population. But unfortunately, as we all know, in March of 2014, Crimean Tatars and all people in the Crimea once again faced with a very tragic page in their history. And what we see now is the violation of human rights of all Crimean population and Crimean Tatars in particular, that could be compared in many senses to the events of 70 years ago. In fact, just today, the United States Department of State issued a country report on human rights practices that cites numerous violations by the Russian illegal occupation authorities of the people of the human rights of the people of Crimea. An important and very dangerous aspect of the Russian aggression is not just military actions, but also massive Russian propaganda and the massive lies that Russian propaganda machine is spreading all over the world, including in the United States and in Europe. The amount of funds that the Kremlin invests in this is truly amazing. If you look at the audience of major news networks, for example, by the people who watch them, number one is Al Jazeera, number two is Russia Today, and CNN is only number three. So this is a massive campaign that we have to counteract as part of our efforts to defend the sovereignty of our country. And speaking of that, we have two very distinguished presenters today. One is Dr. Belitser. He's a professor and senior researcher with the US-Ukraine Foundation's Kyiv-based Pylyp Orlyk Institute for Democracy, who will tell us more about the problems of Crimean Tatars after the annexation and the prospects for Crimean integration, which is the main topic of today's discussion. And we are very much honored and privileged to have here with us the Minister for Informational Policy of Ukraine, Mr. Yuriy Stets, who, before having taken this post in December of last year, was a member of parliament in three convocations of the Verkhovna Rada of Ukraine, and he is a very prominent Ukrainian journalist and one of the forefathers of the fifth channel, the truly independent and democratic, I believe, Ukrainian news channel that was not just a news channel, but played a major role, namely in the Orange Revolution of 2004, where it was one of the probably the only or one of the very few trustworthy sources of news. So having said that, I would like to invite the minister to say a few words. And just before I do that, I must thank Nadia McConnell of the US-Ukraine Foundation for once again organizing such a great event on Ukraine. Thank you very much for your tireless efforts. It's great to have you here. Also.
Доброго дня всім.
Good afternoon, everyone.
По-перше, дякую, що запросили.
First of all, I thank you for the invitation.
По-друге, я сьогодні мав можливість чергове побачити, наскільки є сильна українська діаспора.
Secondly, today I had an opportunity to see the strength of the Ukrainian diaspora.
Скільки вона є більш об'єднана, ніж, на жаль, українці були об'єднані в Україні 24 роки.
And the unity of Ukrainian diaspora. Unfortunately, Ukrainian diaspora here is much more united than the Ukrainians themselves in their country for 24 years.
Ви відчуття патріотизму тут більш притаманно.
I see that the feeling of patriotism is much more inherent to the Ukrainians here.
Аніж весь цей час ця самоідентифікація українців пролунувалася в самій Україні, на Сході, в Криму.
Unlike the self-identification of Ukrainians in Eastern Ukraine and in Crimea.
Я про це говорив раніше на зустрічі, але в мене не було можливості це повторити при тих поважних людях, з якими я говорив з декілька хвилин тому, хочу ще раз наголосити, що...
I have said this repeatedly and I want to say it once again.
Я не є чиновником в тому розумінні, в якому звикли в Україні до чиновників.
That I am not a kind of public officials that are common in Ukraine.
Мені дуже незручно сидіти зараз в кроваті.
And I feel very uncomfortable wearing this tie.
Тому якщо ви дозволите, я
візьму.
So with your permission, I would like to remove it.
Там десь є моя дружина, можна її передам?
There's my wife, somewhere I would like to give this to her.
Так звичніше і простіше, тому що я правда є журналістом.
This is much more comfortable for me. This way, because indeed I'm a journalist.
І навіть тоді, коли я був в парламенті. Як я маю прийти?
How should I address?
Там госдеп.
How should I address at the meetings at State
Department? Він мені казав, ти маєш одягнути костюм, кроватку.
He told me that you should wear your suit and your tie.
Я не знайшов костюм, я знайшов тільки такий чорний піджак, схожий на костюм.
I don't have any suits, I just found one jacket which somehow reminds the suit.
Я подумав, що кроватка червоно-синя з білим, це прапор Америки.
And I thought that these are American colors, red, blue and white.
Але я побачив, що їм абсолютно байдуже, як ти вдягнутий.
But what I saw is that they really don't care how you dress.
Їм головне, що ти думаєш.
They really care of what you think.
Їм головне, що ти готовий забути.
And they really care of what you are up to.
Заради своєї країни.
For your country.
Для мене було важливим, коли почалась війна на Сході.
For me it was very important that when the war in the East started,
маючи статус депутата,
I was a deputy.
Скласти мандат.
So I resigned from the parliament.
Взяти зброю, поїхати на Схід, захищати свою країну.
I took up arms and I went to the East to defend my country.
У мене четверо дітей.
I have four children.
Невелика таємниця для багатьох з вас, що одно з цих дітей є, бо хрестили нині діючий президент Юрій Луценко, керівник партії Блок Петра Порошенка.
It's not a big secret that one of my children, Єва, was baptized and her godfathers was the current president and also Юрій Луценко, leader of Петро Порошенко's fraction in the parliament.
І напевно у мене була можливість попросити, щоб мене не забрали в армію.
So obviously I had some opportunities to dodge the draft.
Але я не чекав, коли прийде повістка.
But I was not waiting for summons.
Я забув про це сказати своїй дружині перед тим.
And I even forgot to warn my wife beforehand.
Я прийшов на писав мобілізаційну заяву і поїхав на схід.
I volunteered and I went east.
І вона про це дізналась, вона ведуча новини, вона про це дізналась за 5 хвилин до свого випуску, коли їй написали.
She's a news anchor and she learned about my decision 5 minutes before she was to present news live.
Що в Національній гвардії створено управління інформаційної безпеки.
She just read the news that a Department of Information Security was established in the National Guard.
Що призначений керівником цього управління її чоловік.
And that her husband was appointed as the head of that unit.
І що він вже знаходиться на фронті.
And that he is already in the war zone.
Так само президент про це дізнався.
And the president learned about it just as well.
Я там погано з мобільним зв'язком, і для того, щоб якось отримати смс, щоб позвонити, треба було йти нагору і шукати сигнал.
There was poor cell reception in the combat zone, so if you wanted to send an SMS or make a call, you had to go up a hill and try to catch some reception.
І я отримав 2 смски, одну від президента, одну від дружини.
So I received 2 SMS, one from my wife and another from the president.
Те, що написала моя дружина, я не буду говорити.
I will not share with you the words of my wife.
Це було некоректно.
It would be incorrect.
Ну, напевно, так само некоректно, що я їй не сказав, що я збираюся їхати на східну війну.
But from my side it was incorrect not to warn her that I was going to volunteer to the war.
Президент знав, що нашу переписку може читати ФСБ.
The president knew that our SMS exchange could be read by FSB.
Він написав більш коректно.
So his message was more polite.
Це не пряма цитата, але він написав: «Повертайся в Київ, мені потрібна твоя голова, не окремо від тіла».
Well, the meaning of his message was: «Please come back to Kyiv, I need your head on your shoulders, not separately».
Я йому написав, що я не зможу пояснити своїм старшим хлопцям, що я робив в Києві, коли на сході йшла війна.
My answer was that I cannot explain to my senior boys what I was doing in Kyiv while a war was waged in the east.
Через 2 місяці я повернувся в Київ.
In 2 months I returned to Kyiv.
І прийшов і сказав, що російська пропаганда на сході в Криму.
And I came to Kyiv and said that the Russian propaganda in the east and in Crimea
призвала до того, що ця гібридна війна забирає реальні жертви.
Caused real victims of that hybrid war.
Я сказав, що ми маємо боротися з цією пропагандою.
I said that we have to fight against that propaganda.
Тому що це пропаганда світів, цивілізованого світу і світу Азії, якою є країна Москва.
Because that's the propaganda by two worlds. One of them is civilized world, another one is propaganda from Asia, and Moscow is a part of Asia.
Півроку я переконував європейських лідерів, керівників неурядових організацій, ОБСЄ, НАТО.
For half a year I was trying to convince global leaders from NATO and OSCE
що російська пропаганда є, вона має великий вплив і з нею треба боротися.
That the Russian propaganda exists, that it has great influence and that they should fight against it.
І не пройшло навіть півроку.
And it took about 6 months.
Я приїжджаю на сесію ОБСЄ.
When I came to OSCE session.
Ці люди, які говорили про те, що не треба створювати такий орган, немає пропаганди, немає проблем з пропагандою.
And the same people who used to say that there is no need to create a special body to fight the propaganda because there is no propaganda.
Вони написали назву сесії.
They now named their session.
Російська пропаганда.
Russian propaganda.
Як з нею боротися.
And how to fight it.
І в кінці поставили знак питання.
And they put a question mark at the end.
І ну, мені було дивно, що така велика кількість мудрих сивих людей.
I was surprised that so many wise and gray-haired people
не усвідомлювали, що російська пропаганда працювала в Україні з Дня Незалежності.
Didn't realize that the Russian propaganda was working in Ukraine since the very day of its the very first day of its independence.
Тому що ще півроку до того я їм пояснював, що пропаганда це не тільки новини Russia Today.
Because just six months before that, I explained to them that not only Russia Today News are Russian propaganda.
Пропаганда це тоді, коли успішним в перегляді на Україні є серіал «Бригада».
But also when Brigade TV series is very popular in Ukraine.
Де героєм стає бандит, який вбиває людей.
Which glorifies a bandit who kills people.
Чи московський піп Кирил.
Or Moscow priest Cyril.
Для мене завжди чомусь було зрозуміло все життя, що проповідником чистого прозорого є Йосип Сліпий.
For me, Йосип the Blind was, Йосип Сліпий was always the person who spread good words in the world.
І моя бабця, яка була з військової УПА.
And also my grandma, who was a liaison officer at the Ukrainian insurgent army.
Ми в неділю ходили до церкви і молились Богу.
We went to church every Sunday and we prayed God.
А в понеділок зранку мені вчителька розповідала, що Бога немає.
While every Monday at school my teacher told me that there was no God.
Я знав, що в 30-х був геноцид українського народу і морили голодом людей.
I knew that there was a genocide against Ukrainian people and people were starved to death.
А мені казали в школі, що Сталін це герой нації.
Well, in school they told me that Stalin was the national hero.
Я не розумів, чому це відбувається, бо я був маленький.
And I didn't realize why what those things were happening because I was a little boy.
Чому така велика кількість дорослих людей бреше?
Why so many adults lie?
А потім я виріс і зрозумів, що дорослих людей немає.
And then I grew up and I realized that there are no adults.
Є просто люди, які брешуть, є люди, які не брешуть.
There are just liars and those who tell the truth.
Є люди, які готові віддавати життя за свою країну, є люди, які готові тікати.
There are people who are ready to sacrifice their lives for their country and there are people who would run away.
Є люди, які розуміють, що такі сімейні цінності, є люди, яким байдуже сім'я.
There are people who realize family values and there are those who don't care about that.
Є люди, які регулярно ходять до церкви, як на роботу.
There are people who go to church just as often as they go to work.
А є люди, які мають віру тут.
There are people who have belief in their heart.
Це віра, яка тут, і вона не вмирає.
There's belief in their heart, which never dies.
Ви знаєте, що на Майдані кожної години різні священники різних конфесій, мусульмани, іудеї.
You know that at Maidan every hour various priests from various denominations, just like Muslims,
разом
Judaism, priests, they all prayed together.
І ми з дружиною переконані, що саме ця молитва і врятувала Майдан.
And together with my wife, we are certain that it was that prayer that saved the Maidan.
Жодної секунди вітер з тих шин, які палали.
Not a single moment the wind from those burning tires
не йшов в наш бік.
Never blew in our direction.
Ці шини завжди палали і дим йшов в бік космонавтів, як ми їх називали.
This smoke from burning tires was always flying towards the so-called cosmonauts, as we used to name them.
Війська Беркут.
The Беркут police troops, Riot police troops.
Ми їх називали космонавтами, тому що вони дійсно були з іншої планети.
We called them cosmonauts because indeed they were from a different planet.
Не тому що вони були схожі.
Not because they resembled cosmonauts.
Тому що вони готові були бити за гроші.
But because they were ready to fight, to beat people for money.
Але не вмирати.
But they were not ready to die.
Ми готові були вмирати за країну.
While we were ready to sacrifice our lives for our country.
Але без віри в Бога, без тієї молитви.
But without belief in God, without that prayer,
Майдан би не встояв.
The Майдан would never sustain.
Я хочу сказати, що повертаючись до теми сьогоднішньої нашої розмови.
So coming back to the topic of our today's conversation.
Що це от відсутність такого великого пуза, вибачте, я не чому, як я вже пояснював.
the absence of large valley. I'm not an official, I've already said.
Чи Mercedes?
Or the absence of Mercedes.
Змушує мене іншому підходити до формування того відомства, яке я очолюю.
Forces me to take a different approach towards the formation of the agency that I had.
Я не назначаю радників і не призначаю заступників.
I don't appoint advisors and I don't appoint my deputies.
Це стосувалося Криму.
The same applied to Crimea.
Ми зібралися разом з Мустафою Джамілєвим.
Together with Mustafa Jamilev.
З представниками Меджлісу.
We gathered along with Meджліс representatives.
З журналістами, які були змушені виїхати з Криму.
Along with journalists that were forced to leave Crimea.
З громадськими активістами, кримськими татарами.
And with civic activists and Crimean Tatars.
Вони сказали, ти маєш призначити радника, який буде займатися окремою інформаційною політикою в світі щодо Криму.
They said that I should appoint an advisor who would be responsible for special information policy regarding Crimea in the world.
Я сказав їм, от виберіть серед себе цю людину, я призначу її радником.
And I said, please choose someone among yourself and I would appoint that person.
Вони вибрали Сергія Костинського.
They chose Сергій Костинський.
Який тепер щодня?
Who is now every day?
Тримає мене отак за горло.
Holding my throat like this.
І каже, я тобі не дам забути про Крим.
And says, I shall never let you forget about Crimea.
Я йому кажу, пусти, я і так не забуваю.
And I say, I tell him, please let me breathe, I don't forget either.
Він каже, ми існуємо для того, щоб так тримати владу.
And he says that it's my job to hold the government like this.
Тому я до того вже звик.
So I'm used to having his fingers around my neck.
Але велика кількість політиків і в світі, і в Україні.
But many politicians in the world and in Ukraine too.
На жаль.
Unfortunately.
Хочуть забути про проблему анексії Криму.
Are willing to forget about the problem of annexation of Crimea.
Їм то незручно.
They feel uncomfortable with it.
Таке от питання, про яке не хочеться говорити іноді в дипломатичних колах.
That's a question sometimes they are unwilling to discuss in diplomatic circles.
Якось незручно одягнути футболку на якомусь дипломатичному прийомі, де написано «Крим – це Україна».
For example, it's inconvenient for them to wear a t-shirt that says Crimea is a Ukraine and to go to a diplomatic reception.
Так само, як і деяким моїм колегам-міністрам незручно називати війну Росії проти України на Сході війною.
Just as some of my colleagues feel uncomfortable calling the war of Russia against Ukraine in the East just like a war.
Але я цю війну називаю війною.
But I call the war the war.
І я щодня не даю забути своїм колегам-політикам і в Україні, і в світі про те, що Крим незаконно анексований Росією, і Крим – це частина України, і Крим повернеться до України.
And every day I prevent my fellow politicians in Ukraine and in the world from forgetting that Crimea was illegally annexed. And I remind them that Crimea is Ukraine and that it will return to Ukraine one day.
У 2004 році, коли я був ініціатором голодування на п'ятому каналі на знак того, що хотіли закрити єдиний острівок свободи слова в Україні, п'ятий канал.
In 2004, when I was the initiator of the hunger strike at Channel 5, when they wanted to close the only free media in Ukraine.
Моя дружина була поруч з пов'язкою, я голодую.
My wife stood next to me and she was also on a hunger strike.
Потім під всі інші акції ми на всіх ходили разом.
And we went to all other events together.
Чому я ніколи не дам забути про Крим?
So why I will never allow them to forget about Crimea?
Тому що ця от незручність для якихось політиків говорити про проблему Криму.
Because when some politicians are uncomfortable speaking about the Crimean problem,
для мене знак дорівнює, що я потім не зможу пояснити і їй, і своїм дітям, чому я дозволив собі забути про проблему Криму.
So, I cannot act like this because I can never explain to her and to my children why I ever forgot about the Crimean problem.
Так само, як я не зміг їм пояснити, чому в червні минулого року я
Just as I would not be able to explain them if I hadn't gone east the last summer.
Тому тут в світі і всередині в Україні я постійно їжджу і нагадую про проблему російської пропаганди, яка зробила зомбування людей і на сході, і в Криму. Я говорю про те, що є проблема Криму і Крим. Ми маємо не забувати, ми маємо обернути в межі юридичної України.
That's why I keep traveling the world and saying in every country and also in Ukraine that we must not forget about Crimea and we must return Crimea to Ukraine.
Останній рік я живу за принципом того, що написано в Біблії, роби що можеш.
For the last year I have been living according to the principle of Bible that I did what I could.
Якщо буду розуміти, що мої ці от поїздки, переконання людей не є ефективними.
So if I will see that my travels and my attempts to convince people are not efficient,
то я візьму зброю і поїду назад на схід.
I will just take up arms again and I will return to the east.
Але поки можу, я буду їздити по світу.
But while I still can, I will travel the world.
Як сьогодні в Держдепі.
As I did today in the US Department of State.
Як 4 дні тому в штаб-квартирі НАТО в Брюсселі.
And as I did 4 days ago at NATO headquarters in Brussels.
Як 7 днів тому в ОБСЄ.
And as I did 7 days ago in OSCE.
Як 10 днів тому в Краматорськ.
And as I did 10 days ago in Kramatorsk.
Як постійно в Києві, я буду говорити, що Крим – це Україна.
And as I do every day in Kyiv, I will keep on saying that Crimea is Ukraine.
А Костінський, Сережа?
And Сережа Костінський?
Буде тримати мене за голову.
Will keep on holding my throat.
Тому що це нормально, коли влада тримає за голову.
Because it's normal to keep the arm on the throat of the government.
Дякую, що так нудно мене слухали. Дякую, що мою нудоту так довго слухали цим днем.
Thank you for your attention to my very long and boring speech.
Well, thank you. We were honored to have the minister here with us, and he's welcome, of course, to stay, but we know that if he has to leave for some other reasons, we will also understand that.
If you don't come, I'd have to stay.
No, absolutely not. Okay. A few words before I turn over the podium or microphone to Natalya Belitser. US-Ukraine Foundation started working in Ukraine in 1990. We're the first American NGO with a permanent presence in Ukraine. Our very first initiative was the establishment of the Pylyp Orlyk Institute for Democracy. Why Pylyp Orlyk? Because from the very beginning, we felt that our mission in Ukraine was to bring information so that people of Ukraine could discover or rediscover their roots, their democratic roots. And for those of you who don't know, Pylyp Orlyk wrote the first democratic constitution in 1710, which was before the US Constitution and the French Constitution. Dr. Belitser was a researcher in biochemistry. And what was lost to the scientific world of Ukraine was a treasure that was gained by Ukraine's civil society and the NGO world. And her expertise on ethnic issues of Ukraine, and specifically the Crimean Tartars, is internationally known. Recently, I was in a conference in Romania and met a former member of parliament, and he knew Natalya Belitser, and I've met many others internationally who know and value her work. So we are indeed very glad to welcome her here to Washington, and we're grateful for the embassies and helping us to host her. And so without further ado, I will turn over the microphone to Natalya Belitser.
Thank you very much, and let me express also my deep gratitude to the embassy and also to the US-Ukraine Foundation for inviting me here and providing such an excellent opportunity to present briefly the case of Crimea and Crimean Tatars today. And the key who would become really interested in the issue can address either Markian, Pan Markian or Nadia and receive all this information in more details. So, usually, recently, during such kind of events, gatherings, seminars, roundtables, whenever the topic of Crimea and Crimean Tatars arises, I start by showing this symbol and asking people, do you know what does it mean? Facing such a respectable and well-informed audience, I will of course not do it here, but just let me tell you that it is the rare coincidence that just tomorrow there will be the national celebration of the Crimean Tatar flag and this symbol, which is called Tamga, is there on their national flag. This celebration, this day of the Crimean Tatar flag was started, launched in 2009. And I was honored not only to be present then in Simferopol during this first event, but this particular scarf was received as a gift from the hands of Safinar Hanum, Safinar Jemileva, wife of the charismatic leader of Crimean Tatars, Mustafa Jemilev. So from that time on, I always wear it on very important occasions. So please, since this celebration, as well as any public event, any public meeting, even commemorating the day of deportation of May 18, is strictly forbidden for second year already in Crimea. In Ukraine, not only in Kyiv, not only in Kherson, in Lviv, in some other city, it will be celebrated at the very large scale. So just to remind you about this day and asking you at some small, low level, but just recall this, and it will be some contribution of our common support for the Crimean Tatar case. I'd be really grateful, and on behalf of numerous Crimean Tatars friends and their supporters, including our friend and colleague Sergei Kostinsky, who is our close friend and colleague and very lucky choice to get as an advisor, I call to you to join this kind of remembrance. Now, I believe that after what was already said, there is no need to explain why Crimea and Crimean Tatar issues remain very topical despite the such hot issues as the necessity to reform, the going on war, Russian-Ukrainian war on the East, the insight and infighting in Ukrainian politicum, this complicated relations with many international bodies and national governments. It is already clear that Crimea and Crimean Tatars should remain a priority and not be forgotten or pushed aside in any public events when which deals with the situation in Ukraine. I believe that there is no need to explain why it is so, but already listening to the very interesting introduction to this our event, I regrettably should tell you that I cannot share the notion that Ukraine as a state has done everything possible to accommodate Crimean Tatars and to ease their return, to do everything possible. Actually, the story is much more sad. And why it is so? Please look at the very topical, sensitive issue of the special status for Crimean Tatars. You know that traditionally, after adopting the law on national minorities of Ukraine, yet in 1992, they are regarded formally and at the official level and the legislation like just one of the numerous national minorities of Ukraine. At the same time, from the very beginning of the process of repatriation, Crimean Tatars themselves and their leaders in particular insisted, asked for, demanded the special status of being recognized as indigenous people. Because indigenous people is quite special category of minority which combine the features, characteristics of a minority and a people. And also the situation becomes even more dramatic in 1996 after new constitution of Ukraine was adopted, where three articles are mentioning the indigenous peoples and using this particular term. And can you imagine, after all, after over 25 years of elaborating the text of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, 25 years, and active participation of Crimean Tatars in Geneva meetings dedicated to the issue and in the activities of the working group. General Assembly of the UN on September 13, 2007 voted for this declaration with a sensational result. Over 400 delegations, national delegations, voted for. And there were 11 delegations that abstained for voting. And Ukraine was among those 11, preceding in the list of those who abstained was Ukraine and then Russian Federation. So, and to expert community was just shocked because they cannot understand how can it happen, having the term, the notion, the indigenous people in the constitution, the main law of a country, and abstaining from such a great document, because this declaration is something very special. It is described in many, many details from one side. What does it mean? What does it mean, the rightful self-determination, what special rights might have indigenous peoples throughout the world, and at the same time claiming that there is no universal definition as well as of a term people as such, or the nation as such, and that there are multiple situations over the world differing from one geographical region to other, and each country at national level should adopt this declaration to its own situation. And only after the annexation of Crimea, which was formally declared by the Russian Federation on March 18, On March 20, the former Rada Parliament of Ukraine adopted a decree, not yet a law, but a decree formally and officially recognizing Crimean Tatars as an indigenous people, confirming its right for self-determination, providing the understanding that the representative organs of Crimean Tatars, Kurultai, National Assembly, and the Majlis elected by the delegates and functioning between the sessions of Kurultai, are indeed representative, legitimate bodies presenting the Crimean Tatar case. But one of the point five of this decree stated the following. Cabinet of Ministers of Ukraine should, as soon as possible, practically immediately, to elaborate laws, special legislation of Ukraine with all firm legal basis of how all this will be functioning and what does this indigenous status means. And please pay attention. It was March 20, 2014, the claim that it should be made as soon as possible to the executive main powers, Ukraine, to government, was made. Now we have end of the June 2015, nothing of this kind happened. And to my expert opinion, sorry, because of very simple case in the Ministry of Justice, who was formally made responsible for the proceedings, there are just no specialists aware of this problem, because it is a very special problem and normal legal jurisprudence, and just have no special knowledge of the issue. So it was delayed until a couple of months, or perhaps 4 months ago, Refat Chubarov, by that time already chairperson of the Majlis of Crimean Tatar people, took initiative on himself. He just brought together all experts on the issue, well aware of the problem, of the international approaches, of the adopted in some countries practice, in particular, which is very important for Ukraine, using our knowledge of how the parliaments of Sami are functioning in the three Scandinavian and Northern European countries, Finland, Norway, and Sweden. And this working group collected by Refat Chubarov really worked hard, and by now we have already well elaborated draft, which we hope to be soon registered by the Verkhovna Rada, and we hope very much for some lobbying efforts of the interfactional group Crimea of the Verkhovna Rada, headed by the MP Oleksiy Goncharenko, who seems to be rather active and energetic, and also MP Lobinsky. And you see, the things once again start moving due to efforts mostly of civil society and independent experts. And I hope very much that the representative, so highly reputed as a minister of the informational policy of Ukraine, will take into consideration this concrete fact and will apply further effort to coordinate, to consolidate those endeavors aimed at the same goal, and which are bringing much more positive results, then when civil society is doing its work separately from governmental efforts, legislative power is working separately from governmental bodies, and the things are delayed and delayed and delayed. Now, I have just collected information on several issues, including the main violations of human rights in Crimea, in particular of Crimean Tatars, but it will take too much time to present all this. So instead of this, I can provide for you links for the main reports on the issue, at least two of which were elaborated in the very successful cooperation between American and Ukrainian NGOs. And here should be mentioned the report prepared by the expert of the Ukrainian NGO called Maidan of Foreign Affairs. You of course know this, and it was the whole work, including preparation, publication and presentations, was ensured due to the huge great support from the Freedom House and Atlantic Council. And now a number of NGOs from Ukraine and from the US prepared very comprehensive report. It was organized within the framework of this joint association of Ukrainian and American NGOs, New York based, which has a name RASM, together. And I also, it's a quite recent product. It's very important because it is supplemented by the annex, the guide for those who would like to use any possible legal measure to protect the rights of those suffering from their violations in Crimea. And it should be further publicized, the people should be made aware of it, and should be it should be possible for them to make all use from this very important and very good, well-formulated document. Now, perhaps what should be mentioned in this context is some unprecedented areas of special concerns. It's not about just human rights violations, which are happening not only in Crimea, not only in the Russian Federation itself, in many regions of the our globe, but which violate not only basic norms of international law, of humanitarian law, but the legislation of the Russian Federation itself. I should mention this retrospective justice, so-called, when the people are prosecuted, arrested, interrogating, including the actual head of the Majlis, Ahtem Chigos, who was arrested and kept in detention since January 29. Because he was the acting head of the Majlis after Rifat Chubarov was banned to enter Crimea for 5 years at least. It is the so-called notorious Feb 26 case. It is, thank you, Nadia, it is about the big meeting predominantly of Crimean Tatars with some modest support from the Crimean Ukrainians and opposed by the then Russian unity headed by Sergei Aksionov that took place in Simferopol on February 26. Then Ukrainian legislation was, of course, in force because it was still formally and de facto and de jure, Crimea was territory of Ukraine. And all Ukrainian laws were in force, including freedom of assembly and so on. And then, after March 16 referendum and March 18 formal annexation of Crimea, prosecutors, Russian and Crimean local authorities started arrested people, charging them with what happened when Crimea was Ukrainian. You see, this is nonsense, absolutely unknown in legal practices of any of the countries. So please pay attention whenever mentioning this situation, not forget about this outrageous violation of all legal norms and justice. And very briefly, the second is very dangerous role of the illegitimate, including, according to Russian Federation, the so-called Crimean self-defense units. They were legalized at the territory of Crimea on June 11 last year. They continue to perpetrate a lot of crimes, actual crimes, kidnappings, killings, beatings, everything of crime, and they are recognized by the de facto Crimean authorities, which was the outburst of indignance throughout the world, but nothing followed. So there is not enough pressure to demand that it is impossible. And the third report to be mentioned is that prepared by the unofficial Turkish delegation, which was made available to public on June 5, and actually it was in April this year. So you see that it took quite a lot of time. It is also very interesting, and this is narrowly defining the situation of Crimean Tatars, whereas all other sources of information are about more Crimea in general, situation in general, and so on. And so this my research, not very original, because it is rather a compilation of information taken from diverse and different sources, is the list of positive steps taken by Ukraine over the last year. And some of the people who are feel offended by this long delays in firm protection of Crimean Tatars' rights, of not providing for them the status of indigenous people, etc., etc., regard is a cynical approach. That means when Ukraine understood who is their real supporter in Crimea, and only then, and trying to use the Crimean Tatar factor as an additional leverage for developing the strategy of Crimea's return under jurisdiction of Ukraine, only then it happened. But to this, some people are responding in such a way that better to do it later than never. So all those positive trends should be clearly understood, supported, and promoted by the international community, because all of you very well be very well aware of Russian propaganda machine, potent, strong, insistent, knows that in every discussion, even by the very liberal opponents to Putin regimes, pay attention. Crimea, will it be Russian or will it be Ukrainian? How to foresee the possible mechanism of return or keeping Crimea under Russian jurisdiction? Never use the words Crimean Tatars. So there is no idea that Crimea is the only motherland of these indigenous people, and in this respect it is extremely remarkable. That was what was considered something very politically incorrect a few years ago, namely mentioning of the establishing of Crimean Tatar national territorial autonomy. This very idea this year was presented to the big audience on May 18 in Opera Theater by the president of Ukraine, Petro Poroshenko. Moreover, he told that all the previous mistakes should be admitted and recognized, because national autonomy for Crimean Tatars should have been realized in the 90s. And if it had been done then maybe the development of events as it we are all witness and participants of would have been hardly possible. So these words of President Poroshenko are of extreme importance, and I also ask all of you to keep them in mind and to use it in any kind of discussion concerning the future of Crimea and of the Crimean Tatar people. Thank you for your attention.
I'll use my prerogative of being at the table here. Natalya, earlier today you also talked about the importance of this indigenous definition or acceptance. You might also mention the Russian response that they are now undertaking a study.
You see, nothing new. You may know that the Russian Federation has its own legislation, but only about not numerous indigenous people of the North. It has nothing to do with the international approaches and trends, and quite incompatible with the main points and articles of this already mentioned UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. But of course Russia is nervous that such steps of Ukraine and these hopes given to Crimean Tatar community would further distract those traitors who exist there from intensifying collaboration with Russia. And in this context, perhaps I'll use already mentioned the presentation in the US-Ukraine Foundation case of the media holding ATR group, which includes TV channel ATR, Crimean Tatar channel owned by the wealthy Crimean Tatar businessmen, Russian citizens, citizen Ленур Исламов, who was...
Колишній російський громадянин.
Sorry.
Ленур Ісламов отримав тиждень тому паспорт громадянина.
Sorry, it would have been a development of my speech, because I would like to inform everybody that the initial stage of the annexation, when Russian Federation tried to win the favorable attitude of Crimean Tatar community, it used just Lenur Islamov, who took a position of Crimean vice prime minister and was a great hope that he will be the real bridge. And this, his attire channel, tried to get the Russian license, used all possible means to get on air. But it was shut down on April 1, and from the June 17, at the very noon of Ramadan, it resumed further development of not only ATR TV channel, but also of the TV channel for children, LAVE, and also broadcasting of the Radio Maidan, which is a member of this media holding. So you see, it is very, very telling illustration of how all intentions, promises of Russia addressing Crimean Tatar community are actually not just hypocrisy. It turned out complete lies, and even people who were really intended to get things somehow happen in compliance with the change situation, to cope with this new jurisdiction and engaging also Republic Tatarstan leadership to help in this. All of them failed because all of them were lies. And we are really happy for this resumption, because now it is one of the main responsibilities of Ukraine as a state and of Ukrainian society, to really promote preservation and development of Crimean Tatar unique identity, and helping them to develop their own media, language, education on mother tongue, and so on. And I'm happy also to inform you that certain steps are already taken, for example, free of charge language courses on Crimean Tatar opened on April 1 in Kherson, and there are some kind of other initiatives in the same direction. So we are trying to do our best, but we do hope for your effective assistance.
I want to reiterate that former citizen of Russia, Reynold Islamov, is now citizen of Ukraine.
Це важливо.
That's important.
Тому що на ще одного якісного хорошого громадянина України стало більше.
Because Ukraine obtained one more enlightened and good citizen.
А що стосується на відновлення мовлення не тільки групи компанії АТР.
And as far as the restoration of broadcast is concerned, and not only of ATR group.
Єдине мовлення, яке зараз відбувається на Крим з материкової частини України.
The only broadcast in Crimea from mainland Ukraine.
Це українське радіо на середніх хвилях.
Is medium wave Ukrainian radio.
На якому виходять програми, новини і інші програми, які виробляються тут в Києві. Тут в Києві, чується. Там в Києві.
It has news and other programming developed in Kyiv.
Кримсько-татарська мова.
In Crimea-Tatar language.
Це поки що єдине медіа, яке нам вдалося відновити, мовити, але це 70% півострова Крим.
And that's at the moment the only broadcast that we managed to restore, and now it covers 70% of the territory of the peninsula.
Чому це важливо?
Why is it important?
Згадайте момент, коли Янукович не підписав асоціацію.
Let's recall the time when Yanukovych refused to sign the association agreement.
Що було важливо для нас тоді на Майдані?
What was important for us back at the Майдан?
В сюжетах новин.
In the news coverage of that.
Було 10 секунд відео, як він не підписав.
It was a 10-second video of him not signing.
І ще півтори хвилини по 10 секунд відео з різних куточків світу.
And then it was 15-10 second videos from various parts of the world.
Де люди стояли з листочками і казали, що вони підтримують Майдан.
Which showed people displaying their support of the Майдан.
Де вони говорили, що Янукович може не підписав, але українці підписали.
Where people said that Yanukovych may have refused, but the people have signed.
І ця підтримка світу і якраз була набагато важливішою, аніж ті 10 секунд, що Янукович не писав.
And that support of the world was much more important than the 10 seconds of Yanukovych not signing.
А, те саме зараз ми робимо для Криму.
And the same thing we do now for Crimea.
Чому важливо є постійно знімати питання Криму і давати можливість інформаційних потоків на Крим з материкової частини?
Why is it important to raise the Crimean issue all the time and enable broadcasting from mainland Ukraine to Crimea?
Тому що я переконаний, що ці люди, які там залишились,
because I'm certain that the people left behind there,
які ризикують щодня життям,
those people who risk their lives every day,
якщо вони не будуть відчувати цієї підтримки, вони втратять мотивацію.
If they don't feel that support, they would lose their motivation.
І те, що ми тут сидимо, і в інтернеті буде написано про те, що ми зібралися і почули вашу доповідь.
And our today's meeting and the fact that there will be a report in the internet that we listen to your speech, to your report.
Це надзвичайно важливо для тих людей, які там живуть в Криму.
That would be extremely important for those people who live in Crimea.
Тому що відновлення, повернення Криму до України.
Because bringing back Crimea to Ukraine.
Воно може відбутися тільки, коли дві обставини відбудуться.
May happen only when circumstances exist.
Коли піде поштовх зсередини Криму.
When there is a pressure from inside the Crimea.
Тих людей, які там залишились. В першу чергу будь-які там.
By those people left behind there. First of all, by Crimean Tatars.
І коли на материковій частині України.
And when the mainland Ukraine.
Іде економічний ріст.
Will demonstrate economic growth.
Коли люди будуть бачити з Криму, що соціальні виплати, пенсії, зарплати на материковій частині ростуть.
When the people from Crimea will see that the welfare, the pensions and salaries in mainland Ukraine are growing.
І якщо друга частина, вона стосується більш Міністерства економіки, фінансів, Міністерства соціальної політики.
And while the second condition is more related to the sphere of responsibility of the Ministry of Economy, of Finance and of Social Policies.
То горизонтальна комунікація між тими людьми, які залишились в Криму, тими кримськими татарами і громадянами інших національностей, але громадянами України в Україні, і тими, хто опікується питанням Криму в світі.
Then the line of communication between those people left in Crimea, between Crimean Tatars and people of other ethnic origins who are still citizens of Ukraine and the mainland Ukraine.
Це питання міністерства Києва.
That's the area of responsibility of the ministry that I had.
Це питання МЗС.
And that's also the responsibility of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs.
Мене говорили, доповідали, у мене. Я точно не стандартний чиновник, в мене було відчуття, що ви набагато більше робите, ніж зараз держава Україна.
Well, I'm really not a regular official, so as you were speaking, I had the feeling that you do much more than the state of Ukraine.
Мені залишається тільки подякувати вам.
I only have to thank you for that.
Мені залишається попросити ще раз зал поаплодувати вам.
And I invite everyone to applaud us.
ви зараз виконуєте функцію Сергія Костинського.
You now work instead of Сергія Костинського in my
role. Good choice.
For projects which need our help, our energy, our time. We present information, make reports for government bodies, for anybody who's seeking information, helping the embassy, if embassy admits it, usually they do. We're doing everything we can and a little beyond often to organize information about Ukraine, specifically here in Washington, D.C., and also in the United States. The Ukrainian community, volunteers, the people, the Ukrainian community, the volunteers, and everybody who's involved, either professionally, like myself, because I'm with public relations and government relations based, or by the will of being engaged in this informational support. Looking for more guidance and more cooperation with Ministry of Information. And we would like to hear today, what is the ministry's goal, let's say for 2015-2016, regardless of the fact that it's hard to predict, but also what could be improved from our side and also from your side in order to work better together.
First, when the war in the East started, volunteer battalions stood first in line against the enemy. Because the country lacked an army, the army was destroyed. But a time has come when the country started to restore its army. Because the national security is the task of the state. And it's the obligation of the state to its people. It's been 3 months since I managed to organize the ministry and put it into operation.
Це дуже складно було зробити, ви знаєте, що таке створювати організацію чи NGO чи якісь фонди.
It was really difficult thing, you know, how difficult it is to create an NGO or an agency.
Більше з нашою радянською старою бюрократичною машиною, яка панує зараз в Україні.
Especially taking into account the old Soviet style bureaucratic machinery that still exists in Ukraine.
За перших 3 місяці нам дозволено було державою витратити 36 тисяч гривень, це 1500 доларів.
In the first 3 months, the state allowed us to spend a budget of 36,000 hryvnias, which is $1,500.
Але при тому ми зробили певних програм, в тому числі Кримська Україна, на десятки мільйонів гривень.
But we were able to spend dozens of million hryvnias on various programs, including the program called Crimea is Ukraine.
Зараз час інформаційного волонтерства.
Now is the time of information volunteers.
Міністерство в даному випадку виконує функцію координаційного центру.
The ministry acts as coordination center.
Чи усвідомлювали ми, коли ми створили міністерство, що держава не має на це коштів? Так, усвідомлювали.
Did we realize that the country lacks any money when we were establishing the ministry? Yes, we did.
Але ми так само усвідомлюємо, що інформаційна безпека держави – це зобов'язання держави.
But at the same time we realized that it is the duty of the state to ensure information security.
Тому основні завдання, які ми ставимо перед собою.
So the main goals that we set for ourselves.
24 серпня ми маємо запустити канал, медіаплатформу, телевізійний канал. якісної української намовлення в світі.
So, first goal is to launch a high quality channel for Ukrainian broadcasting in the world on 24th of August.
Тому що вчора відбулася така знакова подія, нарешті Кабінет міністрів України, коли я летів сюди, прийняв постанову про передачу керівництво Міністерству інформаційної агенції «Укрінформ» та і телеканалу ТР.
Yesterday, as I was departing for Washington, a milestone event took place. The government has finally decided to bring «Укрінформ» news agency and the UTR TV channel under control of the Ministry of Information Policy.
Плюс на базі телеканалу БТБ, які передали нам в управління 4 тижні тому.
In addition, BTB channel was given under our control 4 weeks ago.
Ми створимо цей український телеканал, чи правильніше говорити, медіаплатформу.
We will create this Ukrainian channel, or maybe it should rather be called the Ukrainian media platform.
Який буде мовити українською, російською, англійською, і там будуть продукти, які буде мовити кримсько-татарською мовою.
It will broadcast in Ukrainian, Russian and English, and it will also include programming in Crimean Tatar language.
Чому це важливо?
Why is it important?
Не встиг сказати, моя мама живе на півночі Італії в місті Беліше.
I didn't tell you that my mom is living in Brescia, a city in northern Italy.
Вона є трудовим мігрантом, остарбайтером.
She is a labor migrant, an Osterbiter.
Я попросив її, щоб вона мені вислала перелік каналів, які є в кабельній мережі.
I asked her to send a list of channels that are available at her home from cable TV.
Там було 7 російських каналів, жодного українського.
The list included 7 Russian channels and now no Ukrainian channels.
Отже, 24 серпня ми маємо запустити це мовлення.
So on August 24 we are to launch our broadcast.
Паралельно Верховна Рада має прийняти закон про іномовлення.
At the same time the parliament has to adopt a law on foreign broadcasting.
Там серед іншого прописано, що держава має витрачати на роботу цього телеканалу 200 мільйонів гривень на рік, це 10 мільйонів доларів на рік.
Which will provide for public financing of 200 million hryvnias annually, that's about 10 million dollars annually, for broadcasting abroad.
Ось відомий того, що держава дасть 3,50 мільйонів гривень.
But I'm well aware of the fact that the maximum we can expect from the state is about
50 million.
And I am aware of the fact that we will find 150 million hryvnias from other sources. We have created social media platforms that united information volunteers.
І те, що я з'являюсь в російських новинах, Вісті, у Кисельова, кажіть.
And my appearances in Russian news, such as Вісті, or Mr. Kisilov's programs.
Те, що півмісяця тому в російський Тартас повідомили, що це був день народження моєї дружини, але вони повідомили про те, що у українського Геббельса родилася очевидна бандера.
And 2 weeks ago, Tartas news agency, on the birthday of my wife, actually reported that Ukrainian Goebbels gave birth to another Benderite.
І те, що про мого заступника Таню Попову розповідають російські інформаційні агенції, що ніби вона керує спецопераціями інформаційно-психологічними ЦРУ там, на сході України.
And my deputy Tanya Popova is quoted by Russian agencies, by Russian news agencies, as leading information psychology operations in the east of Ukraine.
Те, що там постійно зливають нашу почту, ще якісь там телефонні розмови.
And their repeated hacking attacks against our emails and phone conversations.
постійно відбувається загроза життю.
And the regular threats to our life.
Свідчить про те, що ми на правильному шляху.
All these show that we chose the right direction.
Тому що якщо ми їх не дратуємо,
because if we don't irritate them
своєю роботою,
by our work,
вони б нас не помічали.
If we haven't irritated them, they would not have not.
Ми будемо підсилювати це дратування.
And we will make them even more irritated.
І в інтернеті, і використовуючи, використовуючи соціальні медіа.
Both online, using social media.
І просивши про допомогу таких, як ви, інформаційних волонтерів.
And also we request assistance from information volunteers such as you are.
Я, якщо можна, попрошу свою дружину iPad.
Yes.
I may ask my wife to give me iPad.
Що ви зробили з Яною, де вона?
Where's Яна?
Росія витрачає... Вона не звикла, що її аплодують просто.
She's not used to being applauded.
Росія витрачає близько 500 мільйонів на цей рік, запланувало євро на канал Russia Today.
Russia Today budget for this year is about 500 million euros.
Я переконаний, що 400 мільйонів по дорозі хтось продає.
I'm certain that 400 million will be embezzled.
Це ментальна традиція росіян вкрасти саме все.
That's the Russians' mental tradition to steal from themselves.
100 мільйонів десь вони проп'ють.
They will spend 100 million on drinks.
І при тому все одно це Russia Today буде неефективно.
And in any case, Russia Today will not be efficient.
Я зараз вам покажу відео, яке стало трендом. Через 3 місяці ми побачили, що подібне відео з іншими дітьми сотнями, тисячами з'являється в інтернеті.
I want to show you a video that became viral and we saw that similar videos with other kids emerge online.
На YouTube, на інших відеоресурсах.
At YouTube or other video hosting sites.
Зняти таке відео, воно не коштувало нам нічого.
It cost nothing for us to make this video.
Дружина просто прийшла і зняла мою малу.
My wife.
Вибач, нашу малу.
Just a short video of our baby.
Зараз я покажу його.
Let me show you.
Це найменше наше.
This is our youngest one.
Я не знаю, чи буде чудно чи ні.
I don't know if you will hear something or not.
Слава Україні!
We are more creative than they are.
І їхня дерев'яна пропаганда доводить, що вона не працює.
And their wooden propaganda shows its futility.
Тому що іноді можна щось робити, використовуючи патріотизм.
Because it's possible to make great things using only your patriotism.
Ми не вчили її спеціального гімну, правда?
We never taught her how to sing the anthem. Believe me.
Це не було записано спеціально відео.
And it was not specially recorded.
І коли ми його вішали, ми не думали про те, що це буде трендом.
And we never expected this video to be viral when we just uploaded it.
Але це набагато ефективніше, ніж 500 мільйонів, з яких 400 вкрадуть і 100 проп'ють.
But that's much more efficient than 500 million that 400 of which will be embezzled and 100 spent on drinks.
Я вже третій раз наступаю на грош.
I step on my title first time.
Моя мала починає ранок з очі наші, закінчуючи співаючи гімн день.
My little one starts her morning with prayers and with the day singing the anthem of Ukraine.
Ну, це хороший знак того, що бере нове покоління, і для неї гімн Радянського Союзу, та мелодія чи ці слова, вони нічого не будуть значити.
And that's a good sign that we'll have a new generation for whom the anthem of the Soviet Union and the words of the anthem will mean nothing.
Але коли буде грати гімн України, вона буде тримати руку на серці.
But when the anthem of Ukraine is played, she will hold her hand
своє серце
on her heart.
Тримати в руках Україну.
And she will keep Ukraine in her hands through her heart.
Це те, що не купиш за гроші.
That's something money can't buy.
Я на сам кінець, я дуже багато говорю, вибачайте мене.
I talk too much, I'm sorry. But finally,
я вам розкажу історію з Краматорськ-Слов'янська.
Let me tell you a story from Краматорськ-Слов'янська.
Якщо можна зараз, не знімайте на відео,
of course,
я буду говорити мовою регіону.